Good afternoon, everyone. I'm going to just move through a few slides so we can get started with the program, kind of the introductory slides. And I want to welcome you to today's Grand Rounds. Today, for those of you who do not know me, I'm Bob Holloway and chair of the Department of Neurology. I am really excited to be here today because this kind of signals our first combined psychiatry neurology grand rounds, which we plan to do three times a year in September. The MLK celebration in January, we'll be partnering with you, and we're thrilled about that. And then again in May. And I just want to extend my thanks to the collaboration that we've had already with working with Sapporo Rosenberg and your team in putting this session together and thinking about the future combined grand rounds in the future. And this really does symbolize kind of the past, I see Dr. Kane up there, the present with Dr. Lee, and the future of our fields, and the growing collaborative work that we need to do together to advance brain science education and clinical care. And no better really was this on display than earlier this month at the International College of Psychosomatic Medicine, when that was just an exceptional event and actually highlighted much of the work going on in functional neurology disorders today. This Grand Rounds also represents, I think, your willingness to actually have it, our 38th Goldberg family lecture. And I just want to say a few words about the Goldbergs and the history of this lectureship. And then I will turn it over to Dr. Marina Conley, one of our faculty who's an expert in FND, to introduce our speaker today. So Annual and Natalie Goldberg were lifelong Rochesterians, and in 1932, they graduated from the university. Mr. Goldberg was a chemist, and in 1949, established the Nagley Company. Think shatterproof water bottles. Ms. Goldberg was also a passionate advocate for gender equity and other social causes, and they were both trustees of the university and very involved with social causes across the city and our region. Our Grand Rounds, our Grand Rounds dates back to 1985 when we had our first Goldberg lecture, Dr. Sir Roger Bannister. Many of you may know Dr. Bannister as the individual who broke the 4-minute mile in 1954. You might not know that he was an accomplished neurologist who practiced for 40 years, and he considered that his most important accomplishment in life. I like to consider this lectureship kind of an example of our motto, Meliora, given that Bannister's 1954 time of 3:59 seemed impossible at the time. Now it's 17 seconds faster. Our 2022 Goldberg lecture and our first combined psychiatry neurology grand rounds, Dr. David Perez, adds to this impressive list of speakers and is a trailblazing example of that kind of progress we are making at the interface between our two fields in psychiatry and in neurology. And I will now turn it over to Dr. Marina Conley, as I mentioned, a faculty within our child neurology division, and who's kind of leading our FND efforts across the institution.
Thank you, Dr. Holloway. I am so excited to be introducing our Grand Round speaker today. As many of you know, functional neurologic disorders have become a passion of mine. They check off a lot of boxes for me: intriguing, intellectually stimulating, complicated, widely variable, and ultimately an opportunity to really help because there's such a need. They are really challenging. I have come to thinking about the work as almost like a psychic surgery while people are actually moving and doing their rehab. It's really, really challenging. However, what I did not know when I started seeing more of these patients was how radically it would change my lens and approach for all of my pediatric patients. Functional neurologic disorders represent a biopsychosocial disorder with their origins in neurodevelopment, i.e. childhood. I am convinced that we are sitting on the precipice of a new frontier of FND, where we will be able to screen and intervene sooner and potentially even prevent many patients from developing pathology. They are not new disorders. However, the gap in nuanced medical understanding and therapeutic resources has created a very palpable tension in healthcare as modern life intersects with modern medicine. I think all of us would agree that functional neurologic disorders make our jobs more logistically as well as emotionally taxing. All of us in this room know that we can and need to do better for our patients. The task seems monolithic and presumed insurmountable to most that I speak with. However, Dr. Perez has climbed this rock and he's here to share his experience and I hope to inspire us here at the home of the biopsychosocial model of medicine to make Dr. Engel proud. Dr. Perez did his undergraduate studies at Columbia, received his medical degree from NYU, and is uniquely triple boarded in neurology, psychiatry, and behavioral neuropsychiatry after completing residency and fellowships at Harvard, where he also received a master's in translational medicine. He continued his career as faculty at MGH, where he straddled positions in both psychiatry and neurology. He is now an associate professor in both, where he runs his Pioneer F&D clinic and is recognized nationally and internationally as a pioneer in FND research and treatment. As a clinician, he has been visionary. Obviously, establishing an FND unit at MGH was no small feat. It is one of the only places in the country, if not the first, that provides these services both locally and nationally and to adults. As a scientist, he's evaluated biomarkers via MRI of functional neurologic disorders and in an effort to improve our understanding of the complex mechanisms that contribute to them, as well as to help us develop clinically useful screening tools. He holds many leadership roles that include being founding member and director of the Functional Neurologic Disorder Society, an international group that provides valuable collaboration and educational resources for clinicians such as myself. Dr. Perez brings very rare and valuable knowledge to us today, and it is my honor to introduce Dr. Perez.
I think that's my cue. It's asking me to stop sharing. So I think I need a little bit of assistance for someone to take down that. Excellent. Let me go ahead and share my slides. Can you all see my slides okay? If I get one yes that my slides are up, that'd be wonderful.
Yes.
Thank you very much. So let me first begin by thanking Dr. Connolly and Dr. Holloway for the invitation, for the very nice introduction. And I also want to give my congratulations to all of you for bringing FND to the forefront and for working towards this intersection in a combined grand rounds in neurology and psychiatry. I'm just thrilled. And so my goal today is to share with you all what we've learned since 2014 in building a multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary clinical program in functional neurological disorders. I'm also very much looking forward to continuing this conversation with some of you in a small group discussion, I believe at 1:30. These are my disclosures. And I want to first begin with some terminology, really to make sure that we're all on the same page about what we're talking about today. So I'm using the term functional neurological disorder. This is synonymous with the longer term in the DSM-5, functional neurologic symptom disorder. Conversion disorder is now an abbreviation, but the term conversion disorder has essentially fallen out of favor, in part because it identifies a very specific mechanism that may be implicated in some patients, but likely not relevant for all. So we can think about the term functional neurological disorder as more mechanistically and etiologically neutral. And in this diagnostic category, we're talking about patients presenting with disturbances in motor, sensory, or cognitive symptoms. I'm using motor in its broadest sense to also include seizures and speech and voice disturbances. With the DSM-5, there was a really significant shift back in 2013. This is no longer a diagnosis of exclusion. This is a rule-in diagnosis using our neurologic, neuropsychiatric skill set to pick up rule-in signs on examination and semiological features that are specific for the diagnosis. The other big piece is patients tell their stories in physical ways. They don't upfront tell their story in a psychologically informed way. At least the majority tend not to. This is in part why the identification of a proximal stressor has been removed from the diagnostic criteria. Furthermore, while acute and chronic stress are relevant for a subset of patients, they may not be relevant for all and may not be identifiable in a subset of patients. This explains some of the background. The other piece that I want to begin to highlight for you all up front is two other conditions distinct from FND, but in my experience, sometimes confused for functional neurological disorder or conflated. There is the DSM-5 diagnostic category of somatic symptom disorder. Here, patients present with a range of bodily complaints, pain, fatigue, GI distress. And the Rulin approach here is different than the physical examination-based Rulin approach of FND. It's a psychologically informed Rulin approach. Is the patient engaging in unhelpful patterns of thoughts, behaviors, and emotional reactions around their physical symptoms? Also, if a patient with a somatic symptom disorder does not have a neurologic comorbidity or does not have FND, their neurologic examination is generally normal, right? So that's a big point of distinction. The other notion is that a somatic symptom disorder can be diagnosed in the context of another relevant medical or neurologic comorbidity associated with that symptom. So for example, an individual can have a herniated disc and chronic radicular pain. And they can also, superimposed on that, have a somatic symptom disorder in the context of catastrophic-like thinking, prominent avoidance, and other strong emotional reactions that amplify their pain. We'll put this off to the side, but it's worth keeping this in mind. The other distinction is illness anxiety disorder, previously termed hypochondriasis. Here, there's prominent health anxiety in worrying that an individual has or is about to acquire a new medical condition. Oftentimes, the health anxiety itself and the fear of developing a condition is out of proportion to more mild somatic symptoms. Now, we certainly see patients with FND, somatic symptom disorder, and illness anxiety disorder all intersecting, and those pose its own challenges. But I also think for practical purposes, it's important to distinguish as well. Okay, so now the rest of today's talk will be on this entity of functional neurological disorder. And as I began really with a congratulatory note to all of you, the reason for that is manyfold, but in part, this condition has fallen through the cracks. While it was of great interest to early founding leaders in neurology and psychiatry, for decades, it's been forgotten. There's been a renaissance over the past 20 to 30 years. And in part, it's been driven by this recognition that patients with functional neurologic symptoms are among the most common patients we're seeing in outpatient neurology clinics, potentially second only to headache. So it's a staggering number of patients. The other piece in terms of healthcare utilization and cost is that this condition rivals other major neuropsychiatric conditions. And this estimate of $1.2 billion spent annually in emergency department and inpatient acute level of care for this population, while impressive, is likely an underestimate of the actual expenditure. Much of what I'm hoping to cover today embraces a neuropsychiatric approach, one that really seeks, as highlighted in the introduction, bringing the biopsychosocial formulation to the clinic and using that to develop a patient-centered treatment plan. That biopsychosocial formulation needs to be coupled with neurologic rigor in confirming the diagnosis and ensuring that there are no other relevant medical or neurologic conditions that may be perpetuating factors and requiring a different type of treatment. We've detailed our vision in several of these papers that can be useful resources for you all if you'd like an additional set of resources. So what are the challenges? We'll get to opportunities, and there are amazing opportunities, including the effect sizes for treatment response, rivaling anything we see across the clinical neuroscience. But before we get there, I think we need to be transparent about the challenges. And they're different across specialties, but notable. I think one of the major challenges for neurology is that the core features that we use to make the diagnosis, when used in isolation, do not translate immediately to a patient-centered treatment plan. There are a number of gaps, and we'll talk about those gaps and how to address them. And while the biopsychosocial formulation, which has lived historically in psychiatry and other subspecialty disciplines of medicine in less notable ways, has a long tradition in the biopsychosocial formulation, psychiatrists, mental health providers, at least many, don't have a nuanced playbook to conceptualize and evaluate physical symptoms. There are gaps across the board. This is team-based care, really hoping to provide a neuropsychiatric vision moving forward, capital N, capital P. So our programmatic vision is exactly that. And I'll share with you all a name that may be less familiar, and that is Stanley Cobb. Stanley Cobb was a neurologist who went on to establish the first department of psychiatry at the Massachusetts General Hospital. And there are now named Stanley Cobb chairs in psychiatry across all the Harvard teaching hospitals. There's a quote that I really think summarizes both the opportunity and the gaps that have existed for so long. Stanley Cobb stated, "I solve the mind-body problem by stating there is no such problem. There are, of course, many problems concerning the mind and the body and all the intermediate levels of integration of the nervous system. However, what I wish to emphasize is there is no problem of mind versus body, because biologically no such dichotomy can be made. The dichotomy is an artifact. There is no truth to it, and the discussion has no place in science in 1943. I think this is the vision that we want to realize in 2022, not only for functional neurological disorder, but a range of brain, mind, body conditions. So a little bit of our journey, really, when we began in 2014, I approached leadership across neurology and psychiatry. Having trained in the system, I was well aware that there were a large number of patients, and there was no treatment pathway. Patients were diagnosed in a variety of settings. And ultimately, it was neurologists who were evaluating and ruling out acute stroke and epileptic seizures and demyelinating lesions. And psychiatry was evaluating for major depression and chronic PTSD and acute safety concerns. But there was this big gap. What about the diagnostic entity of what they actually have? A functional neurological disorder. Who is taking ownership of this group and ultimately guiding care? So we've had to build a team. And that team has included neurologists, psychiatrists, psychotherapists across psychology and social work, as well as treatment leads in physical therapy, occupational therapy, and speech and language. And the remainder of the talk is going to be evidence-based.
Hey, Dr. Perez.
Yes.
I'm sorry to interrupt you. This is Bob Holloway. You have a couple banners across the front of your slides, and I don't know, there may be a click mark to click out of it. Perfect.
That's Bob, one. Did I remove it for you?
Yep, you moved one of them. Now there's another one that's across the title. I don't know if that's it could be system based, or you may be able to click out of it.
Let me see if I can get rid of that. I didn't realize you were seeing that. Thank you for bringing that to my attention. I see it, but it's generally not seen by others. How about if I put it off to the bottom right here?
Yeah, that's a better spot for it, for sure.
Okay, thank you. Okay, you otherwise, thank you. You can see my slides okay and hear me okay?
Yes, perfect. Thank you so much. Sorry for the interruption.
No problem. Thank you, Bob. So I want to give you all a bit of the makeup of our program as you keep this in mind as we go through the evidence for why we do what we do and also some of the core components. So we've extended the evaluation period. So I went to bat up front and said, this is a neuropsychiatrically complex population. We can't ask to see this patient. We can't be asked to see this population in 30 minutes, 45 minutes, or even an hour, especially if we want to think about leveraging neurologic expertise, psychiatric expertise, having a conversation about the diagnosis, providing education, and then developing a treatment plan. And so many patients are eager to leave that first visit with, doctor, what do you think I have? And if I'm in agreement, well, how do I get better from this? So we've started with a 90-minute evaluation. And we'll talk about how we leverage the neurologic intake, but also the psychiatric intake, neuroexamination, other components. Following a conversation about what we think is going on and communicating that transparently and openly, we need to ask ourselves, how did it go? Also, in this given case of FND, what else is traveling with this particular patient? Not only do they have motor symptoms that are the rule-in signs for their presentation, but what about their biopsychosocial formulation? Let's put that patient in context, because it's going to be symptoms and context that then will allow us to develop individualized treatments based on the best available evidence for the various treatment pathways. So that's the overarching framework. So stated a different way, we frame our assessment as an opportunity to confirm the diagnosis using a rule-in approach. We're remaining vigilant for major neurologic or medical comorbidities that are clearly relevant to this patient's overall formulation and treatment planning. For example, is this a case of a patient with a functional tremor who also has Parkinson's disease? Is this a case of a patient with epileptic seizures who also has functional seizures? Is this a case of an individual with intellectual disability and functional seizures? Or is this a case of a patient with no major neurologic or medical comorbidities, but a long and complicated psychiatric history and a range of rule-in symptoms for functional neurological disorder, rule-in signs? You can think about each of those versions requiring a potential different or at least adjusted treatment plan. So our assessment is set up to confirm diagnosis, but also to wear our psychiatry and psychology hat, to think about that psychiatric screen and social screen up front, not because it guides diagnosis, but because it guides treatment. So let's delve a little bit deeper in a practical way. And when we encounter patients, you, for practical reasons, want to begin with their neurologic chief complaint. So I understand that you've been having speech and walking difficulties. Tell me when all of this started. Did it come on suddenly? Did it evolve over time? One of the tempos that we see is maximal severity in a short time window with sudden onset. That's the tempo of neurologic emergencies, but it's also the tempo of functional neurological disorder. Where are there relevant physical or psychologically latent factors that may have precipitated the symptoms? Most notably, physical injury and physical triggers come up very often. We can think about patients with mild TBI, peripheral limb injury, developing functional neurologic symptoms after surgeries or accidents. Now, if one develops FND after, for example, a motor vehicle accident, the notion here is it's not as though there was direct structural damage leading to the development of functional neurological disorder. But with these physical events, the mechanism that's implicated is attention is drawn to the body. And mechanistically for FND and for brain, mind, body disorders more broadly, drawing attention to the body is very important mechanistically. It just so happens that the salience of physical events, such as injuries or surgeries, are a great way to draw attention to the body. So gather that neurologic history, onset, evolution, potential triggers. One of the really important things to also do up front is the referral question may be for functional seizures. It may be for functional tremor. It may be for a functional stutter. But what other symptoms does the patient travel with? And what I mean by that is, if you focus your evaluation entirely on functional seizures, you might get to the end and the patient may say, you know, doctor, you've been very thoughtful today. I appreciate all your time. But I think something's being missed. You know, my thinking is off. I'm clouded sometimes. I hurt all over. I'm just so much more tired than I've been before, right? I don't think all of this is explained by our conversation on functional seizures. So this is really where that neuropsychiatric holistic approach is so critical. This is the background literature for the role of physical injury in precipitating the onset of a functional neurological disorder, in case all of you are interested in a deeper dive. And this is a survey of over 1,000 patients who self-report as having functional neurological disorder, published in the European Journal of Neurology not that long ago by colleagues in the UK. But I'm highlighting this because we can see 93% endorsed fatigue, 81% reported memory trouble, 70% reported headaches. There's a fair amount of heterogeneity in the psychiatric comorbidities reported. There's a fair amount of heterogeneity in the physical sensory motor symptoms reported as well. I want to state one other thing. I don't have a slide on it today, but it very much is a core component of our program. We take a transdiagnostic approach to functional neurological disorder. And what I mean by that is we've been very deliberate in not having our clinical program live in epilepsy divisions or in movement disorder divisions. These divisions have a great history of doing wonderful work in functional seizures or in movement disorders. But our experience is many patients have mixed symptoms. And in fact, that paroxysmal functional movement disorder in a different expert clinician may be framed as a functional seizure. Or that functional seizure, as it stops to be as severe, evolves into a functional tremor and a paroxysmal functional stutter. So all the more reason, I think, to think about their chief complaint, but assess what other sensory, motor, cognitive, and somatic symptoms like pain, fatigue, GI distress are traveling with a given case. Additionally, medical neurologic comorbidities are seen in a subset that are relevant. I gave you some examples earlier around Parkinson's disease, epileptic seizures, multiple sclerosis. 1 in 5 patients with a functional seizure also has epileptic seizures. This is the reason why we want to be thoughtful neurologically about assessing the full range of their seizure semiologies and types, really, so that when we provide a definitive diagnosis, we do so comprehensively and with very good clarity. For those of you interested in reading more about this intersection of FND and other neurologic comorbidities, here are some excellent articles to go back to at your leisure. Now, after we've focused for about 15 to 20 minutes, and we've gotten even more succinct depending on various cases, we then make 2 deliberate transitions. So Mr. Jones or Mrs. Jones, I'd like to switch topics for a little bit, if it's okay. Help me to get to know you as a person. Tell me, where'd you grow up? Who was part of your family growing up? What was the experience for you like growing up as a little girl or little boy? Some of these very open-ended questions, I find, if delivered in a certain way, can really help the patient feel heard help the patient feel as though they're a person, having a person-to-person exchange, and that it's validating and can certainly help build rapport. You want to complement what I've just said, obviously, by getting a sense of developmental history, relationship history, educational and work status. You want to think up front about any pending litigation, workman's compensation, other legal challenges. For example, is there active litigation around that car accident and potential mild TBI event in the context of their functional seizures or functional movement disorder? Obviously, ask about driving history. And as part of the social history, in essentially every patient, we also ask about life experience. I'd like to take a moment now to ask you a little bit more about aspects of your life. Have you ever experienced very specific challenges, like, for example, physical abuse or sexual abuse growing up? How about challenges as you became an adult and in your teenage years? Any experiences with assault or sexual trauma or other experiences like this? Now, when you ask these kinds of questions, there's a certain skill set that you want to have in place. One is patients may say, well, doctor, why are you asking me these questions? I thought I was coming in for tremor and I don't think this is relevant. And the way that you can address this, or at least we do, is say, it may not be relevant. These are questions that we ask everybody. It's part of our intake to cast a broad net. But I'm going to leave it to you. If you have a sense that we shouldn't go there today, I'm fine not to go there. If you think that you're open to sharing with me a little bit about that experience, I appreciate hearing it. With the psychiatric screen. So now I'd like to shift topics again, if that's okay. Help me understand, how are you doing emotionally over the past few months? I'll notice, by the way, my language has really changed. This is not the kind of language that I use when I was in psychiatry training, or frankly, even when we first started setting up shop. But what I've realized is, for example, asking this question, tell me how you're doing emotionally. What it allows the individual to do is, there's a possibility they're doing very well. Maybe they're experiencing quite a bit of positive emotion. Maybe they're neutral, or maybe they're not doing great at all. And I think it's a better leading question than, are you struggling with depression or anxiety? Also, I'm really transparent with my statements so that the individual knows where we're going to next. And if there's an opportunity to raise a red flag or express concerns about where we're going next, then we can transparently talk about it. In the focus psychiatric screen, I focus on lifetime major depression, getting a sense of generalized anxiety, panic attacks, asking about OCD, chronic PTSD, dissociative symptoms. A subset of patients can have eating disorders. I'll do one or two questions to rule out psychotic and manic symptoms. I'll make a caveat. We've gotten a couple referrals for patients suspected of having functional or logical disorder, where when we've actually done our assessment, we're worried about psychotic spectrum disturbances. They're somatically preoccupied. They may be in the early stages of prodromal illness, and then 6 months to a year later, they're developing a frank schizophrenia. I mention this also because we put such a premium on the focus on the neurologic differential. There's a neuropsychiatric differential, including thinking about psychiatric comorbidities. Okay, so I've highlighted for you all, start with the neurology, be comprehensive, but take two early and very important detours: the social history and the psychiatric screen. You round out the various components of your intake as you would for other patients: medications, past medical history, allergies, family history. And I think it's really important to highlight here, everything we've done so far is nonspecific for a diagnosis of functional logical disorder. It may give you some clues. For example, one of the clues historically is, did the patients have any spontaneous remissions? Were they markedly sick with whole body shaking, cognitive clouding, speech impairments, they had a prominent wheelchair? And gosh, did they have a 4-month period where that suddenly got better? and now it's gotten worse again. Those are interesting clues too, but again, non-specific. So in thinking about the specificity, the buck stops with seeing the event on video, witnessing the event in the office, and doing a detailed neurologic examination. So now I'm going to give you all a bit of a snapshot into these kinds of rule-in signs. I also want to state up front, you want the rule-in signs to be robust, to be readily evident. One of the mistakes that I find that trainees make when I'm supervising trainees in neurology is they'll appreciate maybe a subtle element of variability and distractibility. And that subtle, well, maybe there was a little bit of this. So I guess this might be a functional neurologic disorder. That doesn't impress me. And in fact, that question of maybe there's an element should really be a red flag to say that was not an impressive sign. Let's continue to be thoughtful. But in clinic, we see impressive signs robustly present every week. And these are the kinds of signs I want to show you today by published videos by a range of experts in the field. So here's a patient with a postural functional tremor. They're asked to flex and extend their right hand. What you note is that that postural tremor stops and starts. Direction changes. The amplitude is highly variable. These are signs of a variable and distractible functional tremor. Another such case of an individual with a rest and postural tremor in their right hand. And what you're going to see is they're going to engage in contralateral thigh tapping, and that postural tremor is going to go away entirely. Right, so that's striking, variability and distractibility. And when you see these features, document clearly on your in your notes. Let's talk about tremor and training. This is this notion that a functional tremor is experienced involuntarily, but it's engaging volitional corticospinal tract pathways. What that means is if you ask the patient to engage in another competing volitional movement, it can hijack the rhythm of their functional tremor. And this is called tremor entrainment. You can see with finger tapping that now there's time-locked oscillations of the individual's wrist with their finger tapping. We'll let this video play again so you all can see that a little bit more clearly. Okay, tremor and tremor. A rather striking video of a patient with a range of different signs. So here there's a large amplitude postural tremor. The patient is engaging in a cognitive task. That's not a helpful distraction in this particular case. Now there's finger tapping movements. That high amplitude postural tremor initially is gone. And now there's time locked movement to the finger tapping. You have here variability, distractibility, and tremor entrainment all in one video. With finger mirroring, you're going to notice that when there are ballistic movements performed with the patient's right hand, there's a brief pause in the frequency of their postural tremor in the left. These kinds of robust signs. There's a really nice case series of videos for functional gait published in Neurology in 2020, a really great read. So another resource to highlight for you all. And here are some videos. This video highlights motor inconsistency.
Okay.
The patient has sudden knee buckling type gait.
You take another step?
But what you're going to see is that they can dance in the office. And they can hop on one foot and hop on the other.
Now, do first position, do rond de jambe. Okay, can you do en dedans?
What?
En dedans.
Can you dance on your own without your mom?
It doesn't.
Can you hop on one foot?
That's harder.
How about the other foot?
Also see here, right, is that you want to have a nuanced toolkit of potential signs to elicit. And you want to be informed by your clinical suspicion when you take out a particular a tool from your toolkit to examine the patient with. We're certainly not asking every patient in our clinic to do that. Okay, non-economical compensatory movements. What you're going to see here is initially a wide base gait, largely nonspecific, is going to engage in heel to toe tandem gating. The patient initially falls over slightly, but then continues, and then is able to show exquisite balance on one foot, swaying side to side, but compensated. So non-economical compensatory movements. They actually show that coordination and balance are quite preserved. Here on their left leg, swaying to the left and to the right, high amplitude, but generally able to compensate. Dragging monoplegic gait. The leg drags behind the individual as if an inanimate object, often externally rotated. Highly specific for functional gait and frequently coupled with functional limb weakness in that limb. Here in this video I'm about to play, interestingly enough, it's a patient with dragging monoplegic gait, a functional gait, but also has Parkinson's. That feature of a dragging monoplegic gait is really the hallmark of what you're looking for a rule-in functional sign. There's a form of functional facial dystonia that's actually often confused for facial weakness, And I see this quite a bit, actually, when I attend on the neurology consult service and we staff cases in the emergency room. And patients will present with this jaw deviation and platysma hyperactivation, concern for facial droop, also in the setting of functional limb weakness.
In the last few weeks, as it's got better, I think in the mornings and things, it's not as bad. But yeah, as the day wears on and if I get tired or stressed, it tends to come back. So it's probably more intermittent now than it used to be, although it was there all the time previously.
All right. Show me your teeth. And just try and keep your mouth in that position. You know, sort of show me your teeth position. And then relax. And that does seem to have made it a little bit worse. Can you have a look? Can you feel the contraction?
Yeah.
Just show me where you feel it contracting.
I feel it here.
Yeah.
And then it starts to come down here.
Yeah.
Now, functional dystonia is both diagnostically and therapeutically a particularly challenging subgroup of functional logical disorder. There are some rule-in signs that can be highly specific for this subtype, including fixed dystonic posturing, such as, for example, with plantar flexion and inversion of the foot. In our clinical program, we'll see a range of patients with dystonia as one of their many functional motor and sensory symptoms. But I oftentimes also like to highlight, if you don't have a good degree of experience diagnosing a range of dystonias, be cautious here and bring in your movement disorder colleague. Be very important. Sometimes we'll ask the question, we're not sure, particularly in cases of where isolated dystonia is their only symptom. And that's where I'll bring in colleagues such as Chris Stevens, who's exquisitely expert in diagnosing a range of movement disorders. It's also a nice example that we're team-based. I have certainly a range of my own expertise, but I haven't seen everything. And we continue to grow each year. And that's really our programmatic philosophy in terms of working colleague to colleague. Okay, functional weakness. Hoover sign is the most well-validated sign, frankly, of all the functional signs. I just want to show you all this in a slightly different way from what is classically taught. Imagine, for example, that in that picture, the patient reports weakness in his left leg. Okay, you now test for leg extension. Ask them to push down on your hand as it's underneath their leg. And you can appreciate on confrontation testing that you can readily push up their leg. You can confirm that they're seemingly weak. Okay. Now draw their attention to their right, to their right leg that's strong, and ask them to flex. And as you appreciate full hip flexion strength on the right, you're still looking for what happens in their left leg. What you can appreciate is excellent downward push in their left leg. So much so that you can no longer lift up their previously identified weak left leg. You've now verified that there is an inconsistency in their motor pattern in that left leg, a rule-in sign for functional leg weakness. One can do the Hoover sign in a seated or lying flat position, depending on clinical settings. Analogous to the Hoover sign is also the hip abduction sign, where, for example, you're asking patients to abduct, to push out their seemingly weak left leg. When you test the leg individually, you're able to push it inward, potentially appreciating apparent abduction weakness. But now test abduction bilaterally. And now you show that there's quite a bit of a return to full strength in their previously weak left leg. This is the hip abductor sign, very much using the principle of synergistic contraction that's leveraged by the Hoover sign as well. Before we transition to functional seizures, I want to say a word about collapsing giveaway weakness. This is another sign, a rule-in sign for functional weakness, which is the notion that on confrontation testing, they're strong for a moment before their limb collapses underneath. When you appreciate this, ask the patient if they're in pain. And if they're in pain, assuming it's reasonable, say, can you push through the pain for two seconds? You may find with that guidance that there is no longer an element of collapsing giveaway weakness. You don't want to confuse pain-limited weakness for collapsing giveaway weakness in the setting of functional limb weakness. They can coexist, but another pitfall is that an individual with pain-limited weakness is confused for having functional limb weakness. Okay, moving on to functional seizures. So all of the diagnoses that I've gone over so far, from functional movement disorders to functional limb weakness, are really clinically established diagnoses based on examination. And here, semiological features can give important clues to functional seizures. For example, tight eye closure at seizure onset, asynchronous side-to-side movements as the major element of their seizures. You'll hear about patients who are in and out of seizures for 45 minutes, several hours, almost having seizures throughout quite a bit of their day. Obviously, one wants to be cautious about status epilepticus, but when you hear this retrospectively over and over again as part of the recurrent history of their seizures, that is, in some patients, the natural history of their functional seizures. But in functional seizures, we can do one better. We can aim to capture typical convulsive events on video EEG to make a diagnosis of documented functional seizures. And here's one such video.
Good, good, good. Keep blowing. It's definitely
going to
come again.
So initially, these bicycle movements may make you wonder about frontal lobe epilepsy. But now there's a stuttering course. There's more tremulous movements in the lower extremities. There's a return to lower frequency of the bicycling movements, as you can see now.
Lift your right leg up in the air.
Can't see it very well on video, but the patient's eyes are tightly closed.
Lift your left arm up in the air. Point to the
apart from motion artifact, the patient's EEG before, during, and after lacked any electrographic correlate. Using the LaFrance 2013 epilepsia criteria, this allows us to make a diagnosis of video EEG documented functional seizures. Many patients also have the ability for clinicians to make a clinically established diagnosis. What that is typical convulsive event captured on ambulatory EEG and a similar event in terms of semiology has either been witnessed by the clinician or video is separately provided. So when video and EEG are time locked, it's documented. When video and EEG are not time locked, it's clinically established. There's lower levels of diagnostic certainty as well. I often find this helpful to include in our notes, also because it's supported by the International League of Epilepsy and really is the standard language to use. Okay, I made this point earlier, if we're looking for signs to be robustly present. When robustly present, there are a number of rule-in signs that are highly specific for a functional neurological disorder. For example, Hoover sign, 95 to 99% specific for a diagnosis of functional limb weakness, emphasizing when robustly present. These are the cautionary notes, and we wrote these cautionary notes for neurologic trainees, because interestingly enough, in our institution, when we established a subspecialty clinic, when we started giving a range of lectures, when we were educating across neurology, psychiatry, and our rehabilitation experts, referrals boomed. You know, for a long time until our clinical program grew in capacity, I personally almost had a year-long wait list. Far from satisfactory, we're no longer there on that year-long wait list. But one of the things I saw is that over and over again, we were using too low of a threshold for a diagnosis. So you want to find that sweet spot. You don't want to underdiagnose, but you want to diagnose with confidence so that when they get a diagnosis of FND from our clinical program, gosh, we have a really great track record of that diagnosis sticking and not being either reversed or clearly coming second to a major neurologic comorbidity that was underappreciated, right? Those are things that as you build an FND program, they can begin to unsettle the community if that happens with a high level of frequency. And we've worked hard to not go in that direction. When you're eliciting these neurologic signs, this is a great article from John Stone and Mark Edwards. Transparently share the signs with patients. Gosh, I noticed that when I'm testing your strength, you're strong for a moment before your arm or leg seems to collapse. And the patient will say, "That's exactly right, doctor. My arms and legs just seem to collapse out of nowhere." Or it's interesting that when I'm noticing that tremor, if I draw your attention here and have you tap with your other hand, the tremor goes away. Huh, that's interesting. We'll come back to that when I share with you what I think might be going on. Okay, so that brings us to essentially the end of the evaluation with this notion that you've also taken a look at their chart. You've reviewed what workup they've had beforehand. In our center, at least, we're rarely the first neurology group seeing these patients. In fact, if they haven't seen a general neurologist or had a neurology workup at a different institution, we question, should that happen first? Really, because it's this notion, maybe they have a functional sign or symptom, but is someone thinking about their migraines or their carpal tunnel that might relate to paresthesias in their hand and a range of other things? We can talk about that offline, but the majority of patients who come to us have had at least a prior neurologic evaluation somewhere. We need to review. And after I've met them and heard their story and examined them, I sometimes am very deliberate in taking 5 minutes, going back to the chart or going back to whatever records were provided and confirming that what I'm seeing and hearing about matches up with what I remember reading in the notes that morning or the day prior. Okay. So assuming that the patient has rule-in robust signs for functional neurological disorder, assuming that you do not have a high index of suspicion for a major neurologic comorbidity that's underworked up and needs clarification, it's an opportunity to then share with the patient what you think is going on. And there's a really nice cartoon vignette in Practical Neurology that shows us how to do this. Our approach is essentially what's navigated here, but I'll just share with you a couple pearls. So Mr. Jones or Mrs. Jones, based on your history and based on those signs that I pointed out on exam, you have a functional neurological disorder, specifically with a functional tremor. This is real, common, and treatments are available. Have you heard of a functional tremor and functional neurological disorder before? Patients generally have it. Okay, well, let me tell you a little bit more about this. And that's where I will open up a little bit and share with patients and family members. So we think of functional neurological disorder as living right in between neurology and psychiatry. But I want to be clear. I don't think you're crazy. I don't think in any way, shape, or form you're making up these symptoms. Sometimes we use these kinds of explanations such as, you've had a brain MRI, you've had other workup. The hardware is healthy, but the software seems to be crashing. And part of what we'll need to think about is, why might the software be crashing? And why might the software be crashing in ways that prevent or limit you from moving normally like you previously did? So
hey, David.
We'll work on being curious together.
Hey, Dr. And, Perez?
Yes.
Sorry, this is Bob Holloway again. I just wanted to make sure that we do have several questions. And we're coming up to the hour, so I just want to be mindful of, you know, your time and, you know, have a tradition, but I want to also be respectful of the people who have some questions for you, if that's okay.
Thank you, Bob. Yep. Can I have 3 more minutes?
Yep, absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay, thank you. Sure I thought I had a little bit more time. My apologies.
No, absolutely.
With the introductions, but I'll speed up. So with that said, if you haven't been to neurosymptoms.org, please go there. What's really critical is after you've had an opportunity to communicate the diagnosis, how did it go? Are there red flags to stop? Are there red flags to not move towards a patient-centered treatment plan? Think about this. If there aren't any red flags to stop, think in real time about that assessment that you just did. What did you learn from the biopsychosocial formulation? Are there patient-specific factors that require triage in your subsequent treatment recommendations? This is the most advanced skill. We do this internally, in our own thoughts, and this leads to a slightly different treatment plan for a patient with the same phenotype, such as functional tremor or functional gait or functional seizures. We're writing an article in Neurologic Clinics to really draw out as transparent as we can our approach and this notion that to develop treatment plans, think about phenotype, research evidence, available resources, and your formulation. There are treatment consensus recommendations for physical rehabilitation. Here are your references. And there are now published manuals for cognitive behavioral therapy by several groups. I would also note that there are a range of other psychotherapy modalities that warrant further investigation and may be beneficial in this population as well. Including a big gap is thinking about how to pair the given patient to potentially the most efficacious form of psychotherapy for their clinical presentation and personal story. A lot more to be said on this, and I will end with my contact information. I'm sorry I've gone a bit long, but my email is at the top. And if there's anything that I covered too succinctly, I'd be happy to have some conversations with you all offline. Thank you very much.
Hi, Dr. Perez, this is Dr. Connolly. I'm looking at the chat board here. So thank you so much for that talk. Somebody wanted to know, would it be possible to comment on the assessment of functional speech or language impairment?
Say that one more time. Would it be possible to comment on
functional speech and language impairment?
Yeah, it's a great question. So there are various forms of functional speech disorders. Some of the more common being functional stutter. There's infantile speech. There's also foreign accent syndrome. There's a really nice JNNP article across the spectrum of functional voice and speech disorders written by Jan Baker, which is a great reference. And in terms of diagnosing this, for example, with stutter, so new onset adult stutter in one's 40s or 50s, right? That's not the tempo of developmentally acquired stutters. The other thing is, as you do your cognitive and language evaluation, you may pick up instances where that stutter is completely gone, where they speak in fluent, non-stuttering speech. When you draw attention to their speech pattern, it's again stuttering and halting. Same thing with accents. You might find that their foreign accent at times is present, other times is completely gone. So that level of variability and distractibility are some of the signs that one can use to make a diagnosis of a functional speech disorder. Great question.
Thanks so much. People also wanted to know if you'll share your slides.
Happy to share my slides. I'll send a PDF to you all, and please feel free to distribute.
Thanks so much. I think we're running out of time, but we'll be offline.
Yes, we just all want to thank you so much, Dr. Perez. And for those of you who are interested, we are having an offline group meeting for those who want to learn more and ask specific questions this afternoon. I think it's at 1:30 with a group of us who'll be meeting in a group session. So thank you again. We are excited for this combined Grand Rounds, and you're the perfect start to that new tradition we have. So thank you, Dr. Perez, and we'll be seeing you soon.
Thank you very much. Thanks for the invitation, and kudos to you all for your great work. I'll see you all in about 25 minutes.